And Christ makes that possible, that we can communicate with the God that created the world. Everything that holds it all in place, not only created but sustains it. And I thank you for Christ that has done it, that makes that possible. Dear Lord, let us activate that spirit on the inside of us more through our communication with you. Let burdens be upon our hearts that we can lift up at any time, all the time. It's not something we got to go to a place or not. Let us be a church that constantly encourages each other to pray. Lord, just as we've lifted up requests this morning of families that are grieving with the family of Laura Hill, dear Lord, I'm praying that Jesus works in a mighty way through this family's loss and their visitation and the funeral. Dear Lord, and I pray for ones that are recovering from miraculous surgeries. And that's what I'm going to say because we see miracles all the time. Our reading this week was about healings and miracles constantly. And we see them. But man, the church needs to come alongside and pray for the process moving forward from this. And I pray that this recovery process allows opportunities for this woman to be encouraged, to see the healing power of Jesus come upon her. Dear Lord, as well as those from my school that are dealing with stage 4 cancer, dear Lord, that is not bigger than you. Dear Lord, ones that are dealing with brain surgery, that is not bigger than you. Dear Lord, I pray that these situations would draw us all to a place closer with you. And dear Lord, I praise you for the 96-year-old lady that is still allowing you to work in her heart and is still seeking you out, and you're still moving in that. We're never too old. As long as there's air in our lungs, we are not too old for you to use us in a mighty way, because you used her in my life just driving down the road. And I pray we always would keep our eyes open. Bless this morning services. I know you've put a great word upon Kyle's heart. Remove him and anything he would say. Give him peace and comfort to share openly and honestly and confidently your truth to us this morning, that we would have ears and eyes and hearts that would receive it. In Jesus' name, amen.
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. The waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I fail me now, you won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out.
All right. I know that we have got a lot of ground to cover today, so hold tight as we're going to be going at warp speed today for sure, right? Good to see all of you all out and about. For those who are in person, those are at home worshiping, right? And praise the Lord for that as well. It is good to see you. I know that Bobby Joe covered lots of those announcements, right? And I do want to talk really quickly on that prayer walk tonight, 4 o'clock, just so that you're aware of what's going on there. One Bridge to Hope, transitional home for ladies coming out of jail or prison, right? That can be better fit for society to help groom, do lots of things. So it's a great spot there. We're going to be stopping to pray there early because of just time restraints at that facility. So stopping there and then heading to the Berg. So I encourage you to come out, right? It'll be an early night and you can still do what you've been doing every other Sunday night, right? You'll have plenty of time to be able to still do those things. So, hey, get in while the getting's good tonight. And next week we will be kicking back off in-person services for Sunday evening. So excited about all that as well. Continue to be in prayer for our church as new church year kicks off here September. Lots of things going on. Lots of needs still out there for not only different committees but positions. Lots of work to be done with only a very few people to do it. Come on, right? So I just pray as the Lord leads you through that, that you will be obedient and listen to Him, not to anybody or anything else. Listen to the Lord and allow Him to lead you, and we'll be okay with that, right? If you need to talk to somebody with the nominating committee, you see their names are in the bulletin, right? Most of them are here except for maybe one, so you can reach right out and talk to them today, and they'll point you in the right direction with that, right? Praise the Lord. All right, very quickly, before we go too far, I know that with COVID, everything that's going on, man, it's very easy for us to continue to get into this poor, pitiful me state, right? And I see it and I experience it every day almost, it seems like, whether it's through the workplace or out in the community. And I do not want to minimize any hardships that are going on right now because of what we're experiencing here in the United States. But I did want to take just some time this morning because of our partnership with India. And me and Anthony have been talking a lot about we really wanted to do a fundraiser. And we're going to be kicking this off today. But I wanted to take some time today just to show just a few pics that Guna sent me. And I want to take some time to talk about it as you all look at that, right? And I'm going to come down to where I can see better myself. But I know that lots of concern in the United States is our stimulus money and so many other things that we are being blessed to have in our jobs and everything that we've got. But man, we have no clue. And this is just one place, right? Now, I'm just not picking on India, right? We can talk about countless other places in the world. But right now, they're on 136 plus days of complete lockdown, right? As you see these people gathering this food out in public, this is not even allowed by law for them to be doing it. But through who we're partnering with, they are distributing lots of good, healthy products, whether it's food or vitamins, right? 250,000 food packets is what they told me this week that they've sent, what they've distributed. We can't even fathom that, right? 250. This is people that have nothing. 250,000 food packets, right? And I know that there are all kinds of places in the United States, several churches that are doing these very things, putting together these food packets, especially in the larger city where people are experiencing really a lot of hardship. But right here where we're at, we're not experiencing that. This is actually in one of the churches that Guna has at the main campus where I've actually been able to be at. We see all those that are there on staff putting together these packets. And I'm telling you, and it's an overwhelming thing, right, to be able to see these people doing it, being the hands and feet of Christ. And I tell you, it's an overwhelming thing because not only are they going through this hardship, right? Go ahead to the last one there, Anthony. One more, I think. Yeah. And I know these pictures are really hard to see, but as you can tell, that right now is the rainy season in India. They experience torrential rainfall and flooding. And as you can see, people with already nothing, now they are completely left with absolutely nothing. Mudslides in the villages were a couple churches that I actually went to. This was here. And hey, they have been just completely devastated, right? They're saying that cases are growing not only by the coronavirus, by almost a million every 8 to 10 days in there, right? Hundreds of thousands of people have been displaced just because of rain. I know that we can't fathom these things, right? Where my heart is helping. And I know, right? I know that there are tons of things. I know there's tons of areas. There's tons of ways that we can do that. But here's where I want to just blow your mind for a second, right? Before you think, oh my gracious, right? 60 cents will provide one food packet. Come on now. 60 cents will provide one food packet. Right, and I popped off this morning in the first service and said, hey, we can just reach into our ashtrays in our vehicles, right? But no, I was quickly reminded there's no ashtrays in vehicles anymore, right? So you can't do that, right? All new there's not there anymore. So, right, we've all got our change jars, and whether you're saving that for vacation or whatever it may be, I want to encourage you, right? 60 cents will feed somebody. And I know when we think about that, that's almost even too hard to believe. But I didn't show you the pictures of bodies that they've got piled up, right? I didn't get into that I got sent. I didn't show you the pictures of rice that they had laid out on mats as far as you could possibly see down the street. And people, I'm talking thousands of people lined up with the spoon in order to get one spoonful of rice and someone to hand them an egg and someone else to hand them a little container of juice. All the while, I'm telling you where I'm at. I'm getting blessed by food from the school, and I'm getting blessed by a garden where I'm freezing, and I'm canning, and I'm storing, and I'm storing, and I'm storing. And all these people are looking for is one spoonful of rice. Where's our heart in this motive, right? So I do, right? I say all that not to shame us, right? I say all that so that our hearts can see that there are needs, right? And we don't even have to go to India, right? If you get your feelings hurt by saying, wait a minute, what about all the people in Kentucky? What are you doing for them? Because I can take you to tons of people right now that would long to have a spoonful of rice. All I'm saying is there's so much more to what's going on all around us every day, and that's exactly of where that we're parked at this morning. And I assure you, we're going to be looking, right? We're going to be looking at a passage of Scripture. If you've already seen it in your bulletin, oh my gracious, Matthew 5 through 7. And that's not verses, that's chapters. I promise you, right? We're going to get through it. We're going to go warp speed, but here's what we're going to do. We're not going to be looking at this verse by verse because we would be here till tomorrow, right? We're talking thousands of messages that are in these two chapters. I get that. I'm not going to even come close to doing it justice. What we're going to do is airplane view of the Sermon on the Mount, one of the greatest sermons, right? One of the greatest messages that Jesus ever preached. And I'm going to be doing it from about 30,000 feet up, right? So it's going to be really, really small. We're going to be looking at the overview. We're going to be seeing the importance of it because I believe that it's not just words for 2,000 years ago. These words are for today, right now, not just for me, for every person that's here, for every person that's under the sound of my voice, for all of mankind right now. What Jesus preached, what he taught right here in this sermon, oh my gracious, it's life-changing. It changed not only these men's lives, it should change your life. It should change my life. So I want to pray, and I want to get completely out of the way, right? Lord, we come to you right now in this moment. We definitely cannot thank you enough for just everything that you're doing and the ways that you're working. And Lord, I do thank you for not only services this morning and allowing us to come and to worship and the opportunities that you continually are blessing us with here at Bethlehem, but just for the church in and of itself.
that today that we would hear your words being spoken, that we would look at this passage, at this sermon that you've preached, Lord, and we would allow it to change our hearts, that we would hear it almost in the same way that those readers, those men, those women that were sitting there as Jesus was preaching and teaching. And yes, Lord, I know that most were offended. I know that most were probably ruffled in their feathers, Lord, but their lives were changed from this moment forward. And I pray that very thing. I pray that even if our pride's hurt, even if our feelings are hurt, or even if it goes against something that maybe we've even thought, Lord, that we would look at it, that we would see it from the way that you do, that then we would walk away changed, applying it to our lives. And I just pray, that you just hide me, remove me, let it be all about you today, this moment, right now, forevermore, in Jesus' name, amen. And I do, right? I love our Bible reading, right? Because we've just spent all this time, Old Testament, as we looked last week finishing up and coming, starting into John, right? As we were looking at John the Baptist, forerunner, right? Christ coming on the scene and saying, hey, guess what, guys? This is who we've been talking about. The Messiah's here. Come and see, right? And I'm telling you, that is preached all week. I mean, that's not gotten old. I assure you, I've been able to just take that very message that we looked at this last week and just apply it, right? 9 miles away in a factory. I assure you, we can apply it to our lives. And we see now that Jesus, right, if you've read this week, and if you haven't, I want to encourage you, get home today, this week, read these chapters, Matthew chapter 5 through 7, right, there's a lot here. If you've got a red letter Bible, you'll see it's covered in red because Jesus is the one doing the preaching and teaching, right? These are the words of Christ. And we really have got to almost kind of backtrack here in order to get where we're at. So just hang in there with me, right? Because Matthew starts his gospel, his account, right? Matthew's not just an ordinary guy. He was a tax collector, right? And in his tax collecting, it wasn't fair, right? He wasn't the IRS that took what was owed, right? He took what was owed and then some. He was not a likable guy. And then when he saw Christ, when he came face to face with Christ, his life was forever changed, which led him to writing his account, being inspired by the Holy Spirit himself. And Matthew starts his account, right, in chapter 1 by saying, hey, there's sin. There's a sin problem. All of God's people have this sin. And he calls it to attention by saying, she will give birth to a son. You are to name him Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. Right, Matthew 1:21, right off the bat, we see the gospel of Matthew being about Jesus being the one granting all of us salvation, right? Not anything else, right? Not our achievement, not our works, nothing that we can do to gain salvation, only Christ. Jesus being the way of our salvation. Now, if we fast forward to 28 chapters, right? At the very end, guess what we see? At the end of this gospel, we see the attention shift from sin in our lives to the death of God's Messiah, Jesus himself being crucified. And I know that we're not there in our Bible reading plan, right? I know that we've not come up on that part. It's going to be coming, right, soon and very soon. But if you look at the last 8 chapters of Matthew, guess what they contain? The last week. 8 chapters, the last week of Jesus' life. So in saying all that so far, right, I want to make sure that you see that Matthew is bookended in such a way to where that we see that there's a problem and there was a way paid for that problem, right? And this sermon that Jesus is going to be speaking, going to be preaching, going to be teaching is something that's so great, right? It's one that doesn't just have a period on the end of it at the end of chapter 7 and we say, okay, way to go, right? Shake the preacher's hand on the way out the door and then we go do life Monday through Thursday and I'll see you next week. No, it was so much more. It was more than just a one-time deal. They weren't just here to what Jesus taught. They just didn't show up so that they can see what it meant to be a disciple, a follower of Christ, right? This is what it looks like. This is how that you should behave, right? This is how that you should think. This is the attitudes that you should have. Guess what? It was all of those things with the key terminology being, and now go out and do it. Right? Everything that Christ said, right? Sure, it was great words. It's great things for us to live by, but it didn't stop there. It wasn't just a one-time event. It was now go out and live it. This sermon required participation. It wasn't just a spectator event. It required his followers to live by it. And I know even as I say that, right, if we continue in the book of Matthew, we're going to see that from this moment, right, is when Christ begins to talk about the end result, the cross. And this cross, as we read this Sermon on the Mount, it should really change the way that we read this sermon, right? Matter of fact, every time that we read God's word, the cross should change the way that we're perceiving it. Right? Old Testament, Christ and the cross hadn't come. New Testament, these men who were writing the Gospels, they had experienced it. That's the reason why that their wording, that their change, that their focus was different because of the cross. Our lives should be different because of the cross. And the last thing that I want us to do is take the Sermon on the Mount, and then we just highlight those things that Jesus said to do or not to do, right? Almost to the point that we get that grocery list of what it means to be a good Christian, right? Right? Love these people, pray for these people, do these things, don't do these things, act these ways, don't act this ways, and yes, God loves me. I want you to hear this morning, right, before we go any further, right? You are not accepted by God by anything that you do. Do you hear that, right? Those words should ring out, right? I pray for those who are even sitting at home, right? I pray that it just blows you off the couch almost, right? That you cannot do anything that would make God accept you more, right? We're not accepted by what we do. We are accepted by God completely and totally because of his perfect Savior who died a bloody and horrific death in our place and who was placed in a tomb and has risen again in victory, and that one day will come again. I mean, there's something that's so powerful in that statement, one that almost should just catch us completely off guard. Right? Jesus didn't preach this sermon in a response for you to say, okay, let's get this list of golden rules down and then I'll be a follower of Christ. He's saying no. No, you'll be a follower of Christ. You'll be accepted by my Father. The love that will be shed for you will come in the days ahead, which we are living on the other side of. Matthew is so careful about his wording, about the way that he talks. He's writing to this Jewish population, right? He's teaching, he's talking to this group of people that he came from that knew their Bible. And I want you to hear me out, right? When I say their Bible, it's not the one that they picked up at Lifeway, right? They didn't have that. They had the Torah and they had a lot of the Levitical law wrote down up until that point. And guess what? I mean, they just didn't know it by just a little bit, right? Part of their faithfulness to that is they memorized the entire 5-6 books that they knew. Not just a piece of it. The entire books. And guess what books that Moses wrote? Oh my gracious, right? I ain't even going to stump y'all on that this morning, right? I don't want nobody being. Check that out. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. Tough ones. I'm not talking about Jesus wept. Come on. I'm talking about entire books. Matthew is so careful about what he's saying in this, right? Because he wanted to tie together this whole thing, right? He wanted them to know that this long-awaited Messiah that the Old Testament spoke about, that was written about, was Jesus. He didn't want them to question. He didn't want them to look any longer. And he paints such a beautiful picture, right? And wrapped up in the middle of the sermon that Jesus is preaching and teaching, right, is pointing to every bit of that truth. And Matthew just keeps throwing this theme in there, right? He keeps saying, hey, Jesus, he is the Messiah. You know how I know that? Because Moses came. And Moses came to tell us of a future Messiah. Moses was a foreshadowing of Christ. And I know I don't have time to really unpack all this, but I encourage you, right? I encourage you to dive into to God's Word, for you to study it in and of yourself. And guess what? If you just read through it to be a Bible reading plan, or if you just put it on the shelf or leave it on the counter and you don't study it, you don't dive into it, you won't uncover what God has set aside for everyone. You see, Jesus was rescued as a baby, right, of all kinds of children being massacred in Bethlehem. Come on, go back to his birth, right? He's in Bethlehem. King Herod says, guess what? Kill all the babies, because one of them is going to be the Messiah. And Jesus and his parents take him, and they escape, and they go another route. Jesus is saved. Come on, does everybody remember that story? Oh, my gracious, we're going to struggle this morning. Here we go. How about Moses? Moses was delivered from a massacre of children in Egypt, where they were killing all the firstborn males, right? He was placed in a basket. He was floated down a river in order to get away. How about when Jesus talks to them, right? Right before this Sermon on the Mount, it says that Jesus saw the crowd and he goes up to the mountain. He goes up to the mountain. And I love this terminology, because if we go back, right, it's almost the same exact wording in the Old Testament that was used when Moses went up the mountain to get the law, when he went up to grab the Ten Commandments. Now, I know that there's so much more that's being told here that Matthew is trying to do here, right? That Moses went up to the mountain, Jesus went up to the mountain, Moses came down, and he spoke with authority that only God had given him. Remember, his countenance had changed, right? If you've watched it on TV, right, his hair's gray, right, his beard's long and gray. Everything changed, but people listened to him because they knew that he'd seen God face to face. And now Matthew is saying, hey, guess what? Jesus speaks with this authority. It had to be just a mind-blowing moment for the readers when they heard this. I could just keep going on with all kinds of examples of how that Moses was this foreshadowing of Christ, right? Moses wrote 5 books in the Old Testament. Matthew shares 5 stories that Jesus preached or taught on. It's not by coincidence, guys. It's not just happenstance. All right, it's the way that God has orchestrated this to tie this whole thing together. He's showing us that Jesus is the one greater than Moses, the one that they were living their life according to, the one that they hung everything on, the one who has come to deliver his people. And now Jesus came. He was the Word. He was the Word in the flesh. And he was getting ready to teach them what they needed to hear. Jesus is this long-awaited Messiah. But we've got to understand about his kingdom, this awaited kingdom, because right during this time, God's people were oppressed once again. They were oppressed by sin and even by the law. They were even oppressed by the Roman government, right? Where they weren't free to do as what they wanted to. A new kingdom, a new people. That's what they were longing to take place. That's what the Old Testament had pointed to over and over and over. Not just new commandments, new things they must live up into, but a new heart. Oh my gracious, right? A new heart, what we constantly go back with. How many weeks do we talk about this concept of a new heart? New affections, new attitudes, right? We looked at that terminology last week. God's people were still longing for this new exodus. The same way that they longed to be set free from slavery with Pharaoh, they were longing to be set free right now. This deliverance from sin's penalty and sin's power. Can you understand how desperate it must have been week in and week out to live, to think, I've got to live according to this standard. I've got to sacrifice these things. I've got to do all of this stuff in order to be pleasing to God according to the law. You think you've got pressure now? Can you imagine if you had to live according to the law? And we fuss about living according to a relationship with Christ. They had 600 plus religious laws that they should be carrying out daily. And I don't want you just to simply look at this sermon the way that Christ teaches, right? And think that these words are just too great because he says, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Turn the other cheek, right? Give a coat. Go the extra mile. All these things that he's talking about in this sermon at some points. Don't just give up and say, okay, I give. No, I want you to let the power of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, give you everything that you need to accomplish this. And I'm telling you, right, this is just the intro. This is just a starting point, right? This was just the overview to see of everything that this whole sermon was about. It was starting about verse 17, right? And I didn't put any of this scripture up here because I want you to start looking at your own Bibles. Come on. If you ain't got one, see me and I'll give you one. Anthony can put it up if he wants to, but he don't have to. I just pick it on him. 17 through 20, right? And I'm not going to read every one of these, but I do want to read this one, right? Because this is the focal point of what Jesus is starting off with after he gives these beatitudes, after he starts explaining these people are blessed because they do this, and you have to understand of how this lands. Right, verses 17 through 20 says, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth has passed away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all of it's accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven." Oh my gracious, I hope you're hearing that terminology. "But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and of the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." There's a demand for righteousness here, church. And Jesus is demanding a righteousness that is one great, exceedingly, of those of the scribes and the Pharisees. And do you understand? I mean, these guys went above and beyond. This is what you wanted your children to grow up to be like, was a scribe or a Pharisee. They knew the law. They lived it. They even tacked on extra things. I hope that you grabbed the most crucial part that he says in there. It's a difference, right? It's one of the greatest differences. "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Do you see that? This is a heaven or hell difference we're talking about this morning. I hope that you're hearing what I'm saying, that it's just not just bouncing off it, that you're actually hearing it. There is a difference, one, a matter of heaven and hell. And I know before you get too tore up, right, I'm not talking about living your life according to the way that these men did, of tacking on 600 plus man-made laws in order to be pleasing to God, in order to gain his acceptance, in order to gain his favor, in order to spend an eternity in heaven. No, these men were righteous, yes, but they were righteous in one way, on the outside. Come on. It's the way that we sometimes display ourselves, right? Even in the midst of when everything else looks bad, right? How many times will you say, let me clean up before we go somewhere, right? I fuss at Kimberly all the time about this. She don't even have to get out of the vehicle, and she says, well, let me go do this, right? Let me go. And I said, you ain't even seeing nobody. Do we not do this very thing, right? Do we not try to make ourselves look so good? Is that not what's all over Facebook? Our lives can be a complete torment, but yet we'll take the best selfie ever, right? Everything's good in the hood, right? Come on. Right? Everything's good, right? Everything's going good in our lives so that everyone sees this perfect picture. All the while, we are in complete torment. This is exactly what these men were doing. This group was doing. Yes, they were clean on the outside. Yes, they were showing all these things. Yes, they were doing all that. But on the inside, they were completely filthy. And Jesus is declaring not more righteous deeds by human effort. No, more righteous hearts by divine grace. Your heart should be getting better because of His grace and His mercy. And I'm not talking about righteousness on a scale where we say, guess what? What's the curve? What's 70%? Is that still, that's passing? Good grief. All right, so I can go really low here. 60's passing. That's probably what I got, and I didn't even remember, right? Come on, right? So here's what we say. A's get you good stuff, right? But C's get degrees, or whatever we say, or D's get degrees. I don't, one of those, right? But so we just start thinking in the righteousness world, right? Okay, this week I've been pretty good. I got an 80 on the righteous scale. Not too bad, right? I didn't fail, but I didn't do too good. Or we look at it and we say, this week, hey, I give a homeless man a cheeseburger. I'm up to 99 on the righteous scale, right? No, we're not talking about it in these terms, right? We're not looking at it in this way. And this is what blows these people's mind, because they acquainted God's love and His favor, His grace, and His mercy because of their works. And Jesus blows this completely out of the water. He's saying it looks altogether different, guys. It's the one on the inside that matters. Sure, you can dress it up, you can clean it up. It's just like a pig. You can take it out of the pen, you can wash it off, but that still don't make it not a pig. You can put glasses on it. You can put clothes on it. You can walk it like a dog, but that still don't make it a dog. It's a pig. Noah, you know pigs. Come on, give me an oinker. That's what I was expecting. It's the power of God that should be displayed on the inside of us. Right, it's not of what we're looking at on the outside of our lives. This evidence of righteousness is so much more. So how do we know that we've got it? How do we know that we have this new heart? There has to be evidence in our lives. Things have to be different if you've been born again. Oh my gracious, and I'm using specific wording because Christ used that word, born again. That simply means that you have turned from yourself, you've trusted in Christ, and now you're living for Him. There has to be this point, this change, and that doesn't mean that you had to be a convicted felon and now be a saint in order for that process to take place. No, you could be a 7-year-old kid that realized that, guess what, lying to mom and daddy would send you straight to hell unless you received salvation by one way and one way only, and that's through the cross of Christ. There has to be this evidence. There has to be exceeding righteousness, and that should be evident through our attitude. Oh my gracious, I know we talked about this last week, because God has been doing some attitude adjustments everywhere that I've been, including myself this last several weeks. 6 times, right? I can't read all of them, right? Verses 21 through 48, Jesus tells these guys, He says, "You've heard that it was said, but I tell you." Check it out for yourself. Fact check me, look at it, right? 6 different times He says, "You've heard that it was said, but I tell you," He's saying, hey guys, guess what? You know the law. You know what was said, but I tell you, you still ain't doing it. Oh my gracious, right? It's an overwhelming thing. Their attitudes are in a terrible place. And He starts talking about anger, and He starts talking about lust and divorce, oaths, retaliation, loving your enemies is how that He finishes all these up. And he's using these examples of bitterness in regards to murder and looking at examples of lust, but not thinking it was adultery. See, they were twisting and turning everything. Right? They were holding grudges. They were being mad at someone. All the while, they were saying, hey, look at me. I didn't kill nobody. Right? They were coveting after their neighbor's wife to the point they were lusting, right? So sure, they weren't sharing the same bed in a sexual way, but they were doing it in their mind. They were twisting the law to make it fit to their lives, right? Now, I know if we're not careful, because guess what? Jesus pours it on these guys, right? I mean, he just piles it up, and I mean, he is just smoting them one after another. He's just showing them the error of their ways. And before too long, if we're not careful, guess what we can do? We can do this very thing, right? We can start pointing out every person's flaws. All the sin that's in their life, every mistake they make, we can broadcast it, we can share it, and we can talk about it, all the while never even thinking one thing about our lives. Never even looking to see where it lines up with ours. And I'll give you a prime example this week, right? There's a lady that I come in contact with work all the time, and I don't know how you say it in a nice way, right? Most of the time, it's almost an annoying way. And I try to avoid just because I know that it's going to be somewhat confrontational or it doesn't go the way that I want it to. And this week, it brought me just face-to-face encounter with her. And I thought, man, I'm really not in the mood. Lord, don't let me lose my cool because I'm trying to be good. And this conversation just starts out great. And I'm like, is this the same woman I've been talking to for the last 4 years that I've been here? And before I knew it, right, she had done opened her heart. I didn't even ask anything. Before I knew it, she was just telling me her life of what was going on and how that she needed help. And I said, there's only one way. And we're standing in the aisleway and people are looking at us and they're waiting to get by. And she's crying and I'm crying. I'm saying, just surrender it to God. It doesn't happen that way all the time, I assure you. But all the while, I'm sitting there just thinking these thoughts in my head prior to, and God says, you big dummy. That's how he talks to me. I don't know how he talks to you, but I don't get it all the time. And he says that you're not looking in the right ways. And we can just continue to point people's faults out. We can continue to look at the negative side. But God's saying, hey, guess what? You can carry all this hatred. You can carry all this bitterness and jealousy and technically never harm or kill anyone in a physical way. But guess what? You've done it spiritually. Oh my gracious, we can do this self-justification and we can put on this good appearance, if you will, but that's not what Jesus came to do for us. That's not what he came to do for anybody, right? It's not what he came to do in and through us. That's not saving us from our sins. And that's making a fool and a mockery of the cross, right? His saving grace, it doesn't just clean us up. It doesn't just make us look better. No, it does so much more. It goes down into our hearts. It goes into the deepest, darkest places, and then it begins to grow beautiful fruit, love, purity, holiness. But it doesn't just stop there with our attitudes and all. That's just the beginning point. Then it begins to change our desires. And that's what we see in Matthew 6, right? And that's about the first 18 verses. Oh my gracious, and he's talking about giving, he's talking about praying, and he's talking about fasting. Oh, here we go, right? I know with these attitudes, our desires change. And this is three different types of behavior: giving, praying, fasting. And I want you just to hear this out, right? Not just doing these things, not just simply going through these motions, not just simply doing those so that we can be seen, not for attention. That's what these guys were good at doing, right? They would give to the needy in public, or they would pray in public in a way that would draw attention to themselves, or they'd make sure that they let everybody know that they were fasting. All for them to say, hey, look at me. Look what type of a holy guy I am. And all the while, they were completely missing the point, right? And I know there's lots of times, right, that things are shared and we give examples. And I want you to know in pointing those out that they are the display of what God is truly doing, right? Not just simply doing these things so that we can say, hey, look at us. We should seek God's approval in everything. But yet we've got that opposite, right? We want to seek man's approval and then just say, hey, God, I hope you liked that. Hope that made you happy. Hope that pleased you. We shouldn't give any amount or anything in order to impress anyone. And I don't care if it's as small as 60 cents or if it's $60 million. We shouldn't do any giving in order for someone to think that we're more spiritual than what we are. We shouldn't pray in a way that tries to highlight how spiritual that we are. Right? And I know that most of us say I hate praying in public, right? But there are times, right, when I'm even thinking about how that something's going to come out and I want it to try to be the most effective and I'm worried about you when I should be focusing upon my relationship with God. I'm not praying to you. I'm praying to God. We get caught up in these motions, right? We get caught up in these things, right? We shouldn't fast so that others are aware of what we're trying to say we're doing with humility. And I know all those things are hard, right? And I know that Christ, I know that he just really nails a lot of those things and he hits on them in such a way. He hits on them in such a way that's life-changing. I know that I'm not even doing justice, but I want you to know that not only with our attitudes and our desires, that our ambitions, our goals have to change. If you look at verses 19 through 34 as he finishes up that chapter, oh my gracious, it's one that's completely crazy, right? Because he's talking about laying up your treasures in heaven, not on earth, right? And guess what? Not to be worried about what's going on all around you in the world of what you don't have, because your future glory is coming with Christ in heaven. Does he not pray that? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Is that not what our desire should be? That no longer we should want what the world wants? No, this is going to mess you up, right? It just messes up everything when we make this statement. I know that you're thinking, hey, wait a minute, is that even possible? Sure it is. It's the reason why the church is struggling so much is because we're trying to please the world by being like the world when Christ is saying you can't be the world. You're set apart. You're different. You should look nothing like it. Yet all the while we're climbing, we're striving, we're struggling, we're fighting, we're clawing all to get all this world has. And God says it's going to go away. I know this is tough preaching. Can you imagine these guys hearing this back then? It's the same look you're giving me right now. Except they killed this dude. Please don't kill me. I'm in a win-win situation, I know, but I got a little bit more to go. Our ambitions, our goals, they have to change. They have to line up with what God's calling us to do. And I'm not saying you can't have good stuff, and I'm not saying that you can't treat yourself. I'm not saying that there's stuff wrong with that, but here's what I am saying. What if God took you right today, your house, and he transported you right to live in India where those people are living, and they brought them here? What would be on your mind then? Would it be on how much overtime you're going to work? Would it be on how much toys you can get? Would it be on how much money you're putting back? Or would it be on that one spoonful of rice? Man, I'm telling you, our desires, our attitudes, our ambitions, they have to change. But even more than that, we should have Christ-like relationships. And this is where he starts this chapter 7. I know there's so much that's could be said in all these others, but he really hits a point because he starts out that verse, right? Judge not that you not be judged. All right, and the world that we're living in, I hear it so many times, it doesn't really matter what so-and-so's doing as long as it doesn't bother me, as long as it doesn't affect me. And we're looking away, just as we saw those images and some of us just looked away. I say that not to shame anybody, right? I say that because those are extremely hard. But Christ is not, he's not just talking about things that are going on outside in the world. He's talking about inside the church as believers, people who call themselves followers of Christ. All the while, we're saying, hey, guess what? You do what you want. Live the life that you want to. That God's love, his grace, his mercy, he covers it. No, we're looking away at unrepented sin, at sin in people's life. And I want you to know that that's wrong. Sure, according to the scripture, that we need to check our heart. And then we can start focusing on other people's lives. Now, I know as I say that, right, hold tight. I know as I say that, that it's so easy for us to say, well, I could never say anything to anybody because I got all this going on with me. Where's the daggone memo at in that? How much more do we just be complacent with that? Do we just say, hey, guess what? I've got sin in my life, so therefore I just get over it and just let people do what they want to? We should be willing to encourage one another that we point out their sinful habits. Oh, my gracious. Right? And even as I say that, right, I know that that's crazy because there's a huge butt that comes in there. But before you point out that sin in their lives, you have to have a time of reflection on the ways that sin is present in your own life. The way that you are falling short, the way that you're not living up to what God was doing, because I want you to know there was something different about the lives of Jesus' disciples. They didn't look like everybody else. That's the reason why that they didn't follow him. Because what he did and how they acted, it changed them to such a way that people said, this is too hard. I'm going back home. Your life should look different. Life in the kingdom of God will look so much different than from the world. Do you see this difference in your life today? Can others tell that you're a follower of Christ, or do you just fit in with the average, ordinary Joe Blow of the world? Do we see a difference in our church? Can people know that we are truly Bible teaching, preaching, believing church, or are we just another building on a hill that says one thing but does another? What is the difference that we have here? And I know, right? I know that we've already covered so much ground, right? But I believe this is the heart of the sermon, these last few verses, 13 through 27. This is where Jesus really puts his foot down. He doesn't tiptoe around these issues because this is the hardest, I believe, the hardest terminology. It's some of the things that keep me up at night when I am praying for you, when I see some of your faces, when I see some of your family, when I see my family, when I see people that I care about. It's the same thing that Jesus saw as he looked out over those people. And I'm not equating myself to Jesus. I'm saying in a spiritual realm that he saw people's hearts. But Jesus doesn't back up. He does some hard-nosed preaching. He talks about this golden rule. And this golden rule is one that, guess what, we should all be living by. But he says the options are limited, church. Your options, my options, they're limited. There's only two roads, two choices, two ways out of this place. And everybody's on one or the other. Do you hear me that? Everybody's on one or two of these roads. Not just people that's sitting here, right? Those people in India that have never heard of the name of Christ, they're on one of these roads. And I can tell you it's on the one that's wide. You see, one of those roads is the way, is the truth, is the life. It is life. It's Jesus. And it's narrow. But the one that is wide is the one that's the way of destruction. It's the one where countless people will spend an eternity in hell. Do you hear that, right? It didn't come from me. It comes from Christ. He says, enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who entered by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few. Do you understand he's talking to people who have lived the law their entire lives that know it backwards and forwards? And he says, some of you, matter of fact, most of you are going to hell. I mean, it's the part that just rips my heart out. He's not talking to lost people. He's talking to church people. He's talking to just like this room here. He's saying, hey, guess what? How do you know some of you are the few? How do you not know you're the many? Can you answer that question? Do you see why that you are the few? Do you know if you are the few? He says, I'll tell you how you know. He says, your fruit is evident. Your fruit is evident. That's why he talks about this tree and its fruit. He says, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Either you've repented of your sin and Christ has changed your heart and you're producing love, joy, peace, patience. Oh my gosh, we got to, next week, we're going to be singing that song. So if you don't know Fruits of the Spirit, you better get ready because we're singing. Love, joy, peace, patience. Self-control. Get in there, Miss Brandy. Praise the Lord. Look it up. It's really quick and easy. Galatians 5. But if you even YouTube that, there's a million kids singing that song. That's fruits of the Spirit, right? That's the fruit that should be evident in our lives. Good fruit. Those who have trusted in Christ. Those who have been born again. Those who have been saved. Or you are this group, this many who are still trusting in yourself and you're rejecting Christ. And I know, right? None of us would say that we are, but what fruit are you bearing? You're bringing about the works of the flesh. And I'm telling you, this is the scariest part. This is the part that's just so overwhelming. Because these consequences are eternal. They're not just simply just a game that we're playing. Nothing else that is said compares to the statement that Jesus is talking about, right? Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and is thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. Jesus says, guess what? There's consequences to how that you're living, how that you're acting, what you're doing, and what I'm preaching, what I'm saying, what I'm telling you is, yes, you can. It's possible to hear this. It's possible to act a certain way and still not enter heaven. You want to talk about just heartbreaking? He's saying, hey, guess what? Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. There's going to be tons of good people who go to hell. Tons of people who are counting on works or on walking or signing a card or doing this or doing that, and they are going to be sadly disappointed. It's not going to be just a few. It's going to be many. He's not talking about people who have never heard of Jesus. He's talking about people who have been raised in church all their life, who have heard it over and over and over, and thinking just because they've heard it and never lived it, that that's going to gain them eternal life. And it's not. He's going to say, I never knew you. He's saying this storm is coming, church, and I'm telling you, it's one that's just overwhelming. And he's not talking about COVID-19 or cancer or financial hardships or whatever problem that you're going through. And please don't take that as undermining or me minimizing. I'm saying that's going to be minor when it comes to you dying and not knowing Christ and spending an eternity in hell. A greater storm, the greatest storm is coming. And Jesus tells us, he tells us about building your house upon that rock. And he says, hey, guess what? There's some of you who have propped your house up, and there's some of you who have just fixed it up enough for it to just withstand a little bit. And there's some of you who have really dressed it up because you care what other people think. But guess what? Unless that house is built and founded upon the rock, it will fail. He says it. He says, and the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and it beat against this house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Do you hear those words? Are they ringing out in your ear? Do you hear that? Is your house built upon Christ, upon the solid rock I stand? I mean, it's just overwhelming. It ought to just grab your heart this morning to do nothing more than just say, God, just reveal to me that truth of whatever decision I made, that it was true in you. Do you have this new heart? And I'm not saying question your salvation in any way. If you know that you know that you know, then live it. Then live this new life. It's not something that I'm causing you to question. I'm saying it's check and balance time. Days are short. Time is near. Christ is returning, and he's not coming to be this baby in a manger again. He's coming to bring justice, and he's going to rule and reign, and that means killing. That means people that do not know him, they are going to be separated. I know that scares us, right? We're not ready for revelations. We're not going there this morning. Do you have this new heart? If you don't, I want you to hear just right under the sound of my voice, whether you're watching or you're right in here, I want you to know if you do not have this new heart, if you've not been birthed into the family of Christ, then God's judgment, his judgment hangs over you right now, and there's nothing that you can do about it. That if you were to take your last breath before you leave here or before you ever make another decision, you will split hell wide open. You want to talk about Debbie Downer? That's as bad as it gets, right? COVID-19 doesn't have anything on that. Cancer doesn't have anything on that. HIV doesn't have anything on that. Heart attack doesn't have anything on that. But I want you to know the greatest news ever, the good news of the gospel, the very words that Christ preached. He says, guess what? It doesn't have to be that way. Sure, you can live this better life. Sure, you can act this better way. But the only way that you're going to gain access is to me is not by dressing up or cleaning up, but it is getting a new heart by trusting in me today. And that's where I just call you to right in this moment. And it doesn't matter how many times you've come to church. It doesn't matter how many times that you think that this has happened or it hasn't happened. You know inside of you, right inside this moment, right now, God's revealing that truth to you. 96 years old, you just heard that story. Still just decided to follow Christ through baptism. There are plenty of people on the sound of my voice that have done religious things over and over and over. And you're good people. But are you one of the few? I just pray right now in this moment, God. I pray with everything that you place upon me. Pray for that burden that you place upon my heart for those that they're not following you faithfully, those who have walked away, those who are struggling with that relationship, Lord, those who are in a place right now where they desperately need you. I'm praying that today is that day. From these words over 1,000 years ago, as hard as they were to hear from this group to hear, Lord, that today, as hard as they are for us to hear, that they would be life-changing. That from this moment that we would take Christ's words, not anything of Kyle Yankee, Lord, that we would take your words and that we would apply them to our lives, that we would be the few, the proud, the chosen, that we would be followers of you today, that we wouldn't count upon anything else other than your finished work upon the cross. And I don't care if you're the youngest person or you're the oldest person. If today is a day of recognizing that you've fallen away, that you've stepped away, that you've slipped away, that you've ran away, but today you realize that you need back, then you just simply just state that to Christ. You simply just confess that to him. And I don't care if you're here or you're at home or when you hear this, that you simply stop what you're doing and say, Jesus, I need you. He's faithful, he's just, that he will forgive you of your sins. But if today is the realization that you've never surrendered your life totally, wholeheartedly, completely to Christ, then there's no greater decision that you can make. There's no greater insurance policy. There's no greater decision under heaven and under earth right now that could ever be made than simply trusting and following Christ. So I just pray for all decisions, and that means if that's right there at your seat, or if you want someone to pray with you, want someone to come to you, if you need to fill out a card, you want to know more, you want to talk more, you want to follow Christ in this way or that way, if you're at home and whatever it may be, we want to simply encourage you to be obedient to Christ. I just pray right here and just in this moment that we don't let this just slip by us, that we don't just slip out, that we don't just check out, that we don't just hurry through it, that we truly examine our hearts, right? That we don't look around and say, well, so-and-so needs to get up, so-and-so needs to respond. No, we're looking at ourselves and we're allowing you, God, to just examine our hearts right now, expose that, reveal that truth to us right here in this moment, and then just let us